Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky asserts his country should be in the European Union in the near future. In his video address to the regional bloc, Zelensky thanked the EU for imposing sweeping sanctions against Russia in response to its invasion. But he says these steps, although strong, were a little too late.
Because if it had been preventive, Russia would not start a war. There was a chance. You blocked Nord Stream 2. But it was also a little late. Because if it were on time, Russia would not have created a gas crisis. At least, there was such a chance. Now you and I are preparing Ukraine's membership in the European Union. Finally, here I am asking you not to be late. Please, because during this month, you have compared these worlds and you see everything. You saw who is worth what, and you saw that Ukraine should be in the EU in the near future.
In the days following Russia's invasion, Ukraine officially applied for EU membership and asked for immediate approval. But the regional bloc said it would not rush the application process. U.S. President Joe Biden officially calling for Russia's expulsion from G20. This follows a day of intense global diplomacy in Brussels as world leaders gather to discuss further sanctions against Russia for its invasion of Ukraine. Biden says if other nations would not support kicking Russia out of G20, Ukraine should be able to participate in their meetings. One wild card in U.S. efforts to economically pressure Russia relies on China's next move.
I had a very straightforward conversation with Xi now, I guess it's 6 days ago, 7 days ago in that range. And I made it clear to him, I made no threats, but I made it clear to him that make sure he understood the consequences of him helping Russia. China understands that its economic future is much more closely tied to the West than it is to Russia. And so I'm hopeful that he does not get engaged.
Biden is headed to Poland next to witness firsthand the plight of refugees who fled the war. Poland houses the most Ukrainian refugees. It has taken in more than 2.1 million since the invasion began. The U.S. is also ramping up humanitarian aid for Ukraine by opening its doors to 100,000 refugees fleeing the war. Details in this report.
The Biden administration announced on Thursday that the United States plans to accept up to 100,000 Ukrainians fleeing Russia's invasion, while also pledging $1 billion in new humanitarian aid. This news comes after a month of bombardments touched off Europe's fastest-moving refugee crisis since the end of World War II, and coincides with U.S. President Joe Biden's meeting with European leaders in Brussels to coordinate the Western response to the crisis.
This is not something that Poland or Romania or Germany should carry on their own. This is an international responsibility. The United States is a leader, one of the leaders in the international community, has an obligation to be engaged and do all we can to ease the suffering and pain of innocent women and children and men, for that matter, throughout Ukraine and those who have made it across the border.
So far, more than 3.5 million people have fled Ukraine since Russia invaded on February 24th, putting a strain on the neighboring European countries receiving them. As a result, U.S. lawmakers and advocates have urged Biden to do more to help those seeking refuge in the United States. The Biden administration said in a statement it would use the full range of legal pathways to bring Ukrainians to the United States, including the U.S. Refugee Resettlement Program. The current effort to allow more Ukrainians into the United States is part of a broader series of aid measures announced by the Biden administration on Thursday, including $1 billion in new funding toward humanitarian assistance to support people still in Ukraine and those affected by the global impacts of Russia's war, which Russia calls a special military operation. The Biden administration will launch a new democracy and human rights program that aims to provide at least $320 million in new funding to defend human rights in Ukraine and neighboring countries.
The UN General Assembly adopts a new non-binding resolution demanding an immediate halt to Russia's war in Ukraine. 140 countries, including the Philippines, voted in favor of the measure. 5 voted against it, and 38 abstained. The resolution also criticizes Russia for creating a dire humanitarian situation, demanding aid access and civilian protection in the Ukraine. Russia, which has denied attacking civilians, calls the draft a pseudo-humanitarian solution that takes a one-sided view of the situation.
Today, once again, the world stood united. It stood united in the face of President Putin's unjustified and unprovoked invasion of Ukraine. Together, a strong majority of UN member states made clear that Russia bears sole responsibility for the grave humanitarian crisis and violence in Ukraine. Together, we called for the protection of all civilians fleeing the conflict and for steps to mitigate the increase in food insecurity caused by this senseless war. And together, we reaffirmed the UN Charter.
As Western leaders gather in Brussels, Ukrainians across the country shelter in metro stations, with cities around them reduced into rubble. Here's a look at the life in Ukraine 1 month since Russia's invasion.
A month into Russia's invasion, this is life in Ukraine. Cities reduced to rubble, long lines for humanitarian aid, and hundreds sheltering underground, like in Kharkiv's metro system. Natalia Shaposhnik and her daughter Veronika have been living in a blue and yellow train far underground Kharkiv, Ukraine's second largest city, since the beginning of Russia's invasion.
Surely it's not better than home, but it is livable. One can say our living conditions are better than others. What I mean is we are not right on the platform. My child and I are in the carriage. We get food, there is a toilet. We are doing fine.
For 4 long weeks, Sapochnik and hundreds like her have hunkered down inside the station in the north of the city, many of whom have endured near daily shelling. Above them, destroyed or heavily damaged buildings line the eerily quiet streets. Anastasia Horkova is a local journalist.
Here, there are about 250 people sheltering here. Many go out during the day to breathe fresh air, go to the supermarket, and this flew here.
A couple hundred miles to the south, the scene is no better in the battered city of Mariupol, where long lines for humanitarian aid have filled a former shopping center. Alexandra is a local resident.
My husband didn't make it to receive humanitarian aid. He had diabetes. The scarce diet of the last days led him into a coma and he died. If he could have made it for the aid, he'd be alive. I still can't tell the Russian relatives he passed away.
Many have evacuated the port city for temporary shelter in Russia's southern city of Taganrog, like pediatrician Galina Ovchinnikova.
We were eating once a day. All we have cooked in the morning, we were eating during the whole day. And the rest of the time, we were sitting in the basement. It was dirty there and dark. We were burning candles, making oil lamps. It was cold there.
83-year-old Raisa Kairat said she lost contact with her daughter and grandchild when the siege started.
So beautiful Mariupol used to be, and suddenly it was reduced to dust. How dare you fire at people? They are animals, not humans. Kindergartens, stores, schools. School nearby was destroyed. Why would anyone shoot at the houses where people lived? What for?
Russia continues to deny targeting civilians and calls its invasion a special military operation.
Berlin's top ballet company welcomes ballerinas fleeing the horrors of war in Ukraine, along with dancers wanting to leave Russia. Take a look.
practicing their pliés and pirouettes in downtown Berlin, many of these ballerinas have been through hell, having fled the horrors of war in Ukraine. They've recently been welcomed into the fold of Berlin's main ballet company by prima ballerina Yana Selenko.
They want just to give up. They don't know how to go on with this situation. So, and of course, I feel like if I can help, it makes me happy.
The Kiev-born dancer, who has been in the German capital since 2005, has worked tirelessly over the last month to help those in need continue with their training.
They're really happy. They're just thankful for everything, what I can do and what I could help. And I feel this really love, like, oh, really, thank you. I thought I would never come back. And when they have a chance to connect it with the people or come in here to do the class, and it feels like I did my job, and it, of course it's just little job, but I feel this happiness.
But it's not just Ukrainian dancers who are looking for a position at the Berlin State Ballet. Dancers from other countries, including Russia, are also keen to join the ensemble. According to ballet dramaturg Christian Theobald, the Berlin Opera prides itself on being a melting pot of global talent.
We have many, many nationalities here, and we have an important duty to ensure Russophobia doesn't emerge and that we continue to value each other just as before as we carry on.
Together, Theobald and Selenko are not only helping the displaced ballerinas with accommodation, ballet shoes, and practice space, they are also trying to get the dancers auditions at ballet companies abroad or in other fields such as the opera.